Welcome to Gergo Print 3D with a simple video this time.
So this is how long the Comgrow T300 takes to boot after turning it on. I thought I'd make a video how the device screen works. It is a simplified interface, but it has all the essentials. I think it's the best for beginners. And in the next video, I will show you the mainsail and fluid interface on the remote computer. If videos like this interest you, please consider liking this video and subscribing to my channel. I mainly work with Sovol and now Comgrow devices. This is a pre-production unit, so the user interface and all the options might change in production versions, and they can surely change with software updates, of course. If there are any changes that I receive, I will post a new video. So you see, we have the printer booted up and we arrive on this home screen, which shows us the temperature of the nozzle and the temperature of the bed. There is a switch for the light, so you can quickly turn it on and off. Compared to a Sovol or other Klipper printers, this works very quickly. Pressing the Wi-Fi icon shows us the IP address, another very beginner-friendly option there. The main menu items, or the menu items along the left edge of the screen. The next one is for settings, and you can see that it's split into three sections on the top. The first one is XYZ axis. This is all about moving the tool head of the printer. If you just try to press these buttons, it will tell you to home the printer first. All the messages that come up have this sure button on it, so the message doesn't disappear. You will have to press the sure button to remove it. So first you have to home, and of course there is a home button for both the horizontal controls and the vertical controls, but you first have to do home all, which is on the side here. So I press that, and you can see that the print head finds the extremes of the build volume and then homes in the center of the screen. This is very much like any other Klipper printer. All Klipper printers work like this. Once homed, they know their position, so now you can raise the print head by the amount set there. So the amount is 1 millimeter by default, but you can go up as high as 50 millimeters and it will raise by 50 millimeters if I press the plus button. Let me quickly clear away some of this gunk that is stuck to the nozzle. We also have an off button here, which will dislock the motors. You can probably hear the sound of the primed motors. If I click here, the motors are disengaged. Now we can move the tool head and the bed manually, and we can even rotate this top bar here with the Z axis. But if we want to control again, we would have to home again. So if you unlock, you will have to home again, just like any other Klipper printer, by the way. So the next item on the top here is the material control, the one to load and unload filament and to heat up the nozzle and the bed. So you click here and you can punch in the value for the nozzle temperature and for the bed temperature. You have to set at least 200 degrees for these feed and retreat buttons to work. Retreat will unload the filament, feed will load the filament. And we have these preset buttons here, PLA, ABS and cooling. PLA heats to 200/50, ABS to 250/70, and the cooling button will cool the nozzle with the part fan. So moving on to control, we can control the LED here. Again, the home screen has a quick button for it as well. And we can turn off this beep sound if it's bothering us. And we also have a model fan control here, which running at 100%, it is pretty loud. And usually the interface is pretty responsive, but this seek bar is a little bit finicky. So this concludes this control section or this settings section of the device screen. So we can move on to this next one, which is for printing. So here it shows the internal storage and all the G codes that are stored in the internal storage. You can upload files here from your computer, from the Cura slicer or Orca slicer if you set it up. You see some of the thumbnails are missing because my pre-production unit seems to be only able to handle JPG type thumbnails. This again hopefully will change in software updates. So we have a tiny button down here in the corner to move down to the next page, and then it shows the rest of the items that I sent to the printer. You see later I realized how to set thumbnail images using JPEG thumbnails, so we have thumbnails there. So for each print we have a delete button, the trash can. It shows us the print time, 12 minutes for the benchy, and the amount of filament that is needed for that benchy. So pressing this button will bring up the intermediate screen, which should show a bigger size thumbnail of the print, but it doesn't work in my pre-production unit. And again, the same information is repeated here. The full name of the G code is up there, and we have an option to enable delayed photography, which is their word for time lapse. Now, if you enable this, it will just create a time-based time lapse. So it will take a photo using this external camera that is plugged into the USB port every second or so. It's just a sped up version of the print. You can make much better time lapses if you use the macros built into the system. It's all enabled, and I will make a video explaining all this. Pressing the print button will start the print, of course. During the print, we are going to see this screen with information about the print, the progress bar at the bottom, above it the pause and stop buttons. On the right side of the screen, you can still change the nozzle and bed temperatures. You can toggle the light and also view your IP address in case you want to connect to the printer wirelessly. Pressing the adjust button will take you to this screen where you can adjust your Z height on the left side of the screen. You can use the change material button to unload your filament and load a different material. You can adjust the flow rate and the print speed in steps of 1, 5, 10, or 25%. And at the bottom of the screen, you see the part fan speed, which is adjustable. Press the back arrow on the top to go back to the print screen. And at the end of the print, it will also tell you the total time the print took. Going back, we have the second option is the USB disk. So if you have a USB thumb drive plugged in one of the USB ports of the machine on the left side of the device, it will show you the G-code files there. So you can carry your G-codes to the printer on a thumb drive as well. You are not limited to the network. By the way, the network access is through Wi-Fi or Ethernet cabled network. And you can watch your delayed photography, export them to your USB drive. So this is again very beginner friendly, very user friendly. If somebody wants to use just the device screen, no network access, they can manage all their time lapses through here and easily delete, free up space in the local storage, and export these videos to their thumb drive. Okay, moving on to the last item on the left. I think this is the settings. The previous one is probably would be called control. So the last one is for settings. So we have some system settings here controlling the screen brightness going from 20 to 100%. Breath green is the time after the screen turns off. You can disable that option. Ever is probably for never. So my screen never goes out, but you can set it to 5, 10, 15, 30 minutes. Then you have to touch the screen to turn it on. You can set language, and here are the built-in options. These are the languages the device screen works in. And we have a factory reset and a version number. So this is the version number of the firmware on my printer. I will make another video on how to update the firmware in the printer. You have to access the controller card from the bottom. It's not easy. You have to flip the printer on its side, take off the bottom cover, and then take out the little EMMC card from there. And with the included EMMC card reader writer, you can use your computer to burn new firmware on the controller board. Then you have to take apart the screen and use a micro SD card to update the screen. And then you will still have to update the controller board with a thumb drive with the firmware. So it's a three-step method, not the most convenient at this point, but again, that's something that might even change in the future. Over the air updates would be the nicest, of course. So moving on to the next screen is the network. It will scan your area and show all the detected Wi-Fi channels, and you can pick the one that you want to use or disable wireless LAN all the way. Finally, the last item here on the top is level calibrate, which is actually where you start when you first start to use this printer. So you would have to do a Z calibration. There is a start button for it here, and then you can move the print head up and down. They included that leveling card for the exact distance from the build plate. You can see mine is set to 2.520. Below there, we have the Z-axis tilt calibrate, which would do the top ramming method by default, since this printer only has a single Z driver. So its only way to level the X-axis is by driving all the way to the top and then forcing it to become level. In my pre-production unit, it wasn't very accurate, so I came up with a different method, which I will show in a next video, but I was able to assign it to the same calibrate button, which is great. You've now seen everything. This is the last screen on this device screen, so there is no way to start macros or even to shut down the machine or emergency stop the machine currently. Hopefully in software updates they are going to give us some more ways to control the printer with custom functions, but at this point I was only able to customize this single button, which is enough for the new Z calibration method that I implemented and I will show you. And finally, we have the calibrate heatbed leveling. So that's basically the ABL scan, 81.9 by 9 mesh. It will automatically heat the bed to 60 degrees and do the mesh level at 60 degrees. Now, I changed that macro as well. So if you heat the bed to a different temperature, it will do that mesh at that different temperature. So now I went back to the main screen. You can see how quickly it heats to 65 degrees. In about a minute, it goes from room temperature to 60 degrees. This is extremely fast, you can see there. The device screen is only capable of storing one mesh at one temperature, but the Klipper system is open, and if you do the bed mesh from the remote interface, it will be able to store many different meshes if you want. Going back to the screen, you can see now we have reached the 65 degrees. There is a step there in the chart because it wasn't drawing the chart when I was away from that screen. Let's finish by doing bed mesh by pressing the calibrate button here, and you will be able to see it as I say goodbye. Again, I'm planning to do many more videos about my Sovol SVO 7 Plus, my Sovol SVO 6 Plus with Klipper, and many more videos of this printer, the Comgrow T300. So if videos like this interest you, if you have or plan have a printer like this or plan to get a printer like this, I think signing up, subscribing to my channel GergoPrint3D will be very useful for you. You can see the speed at which the bed mesh is created, 81 points, 9 rows and 9 columns, and it's all automatically stored at the end. With this, I'm say goodbye. In the next video, I will take you around the mainsail and fluid remote interfaces of this very printer, and I have many other videos planned comparing with the Sovols, printing some useful mods like this gantry calibration mod that I did. You can also hear that this printer is almost completely silent. That's thanks to an updated fan for the controller board. So I will show you how to do that and give you all the different STR models that I designed for this. There will be other projects done with this printer, so stay tuned and be sure to subscribe. With this, I end this video, and as always, go print 3D.